remember the first time you actually held a guitar and what it felt like beneath your fingers? And I mean, was it like a, was it a transformation or was it like, yeah, this?
Well, I saw the Beatles on TV, same as everybody else who's my age, you know, and that changed everything. You know? And it was the on switch to my life. It was weird. You know, my mother, this is the weird part. When my mother was pregnant, she was 19 when she was pregnant. They had me when she was 20.
Wow.
some psychic went up to her and put her hand on my mom's belly. And said, ah, it's a boy musician. Here's the music. And, well, people are going to know this kid. When he's 7, something's going to happen. It's going to change everything. And my mom was like, what? Musician? Like, you know, this is 1957, I understand. So it wasn't exactly cool to have a musician son then. Especially when you're just a kid yourself. I mean, it's staggering that my mother was pregnant at 19 years old. But back then, that wasn't that weird, I guess. And consequently, I was 7 years old when I saw the Beatles and I got my first guitar. And honestly, for a while, it was a struggle. Just to, yeah. I held it and I wanted to do it. And we all did the tennis racket routine. It's the 60s, early 60s. And, you know, just the sound of that just got inside of my DNA and just kind of opened it up. Something changed that time. And one day, as weird as it sounds, one day I was struggling with this guitar on the front porch of my mom and dad's house, and my hands fell into the first position chords, and I just knew them all, and no one ever showed them to me, and I just started playing. I know people are going, this is guy high, too much drugs in the 80s or whatever, but that's the God's often truth. All of a sudden, the whole instrument made sense to me, and my ears opened up at the same time, and all of a sudden I was able to pick things out, and I got the, you know, then I got the book with all the Beatle chords in it, and I could just figure out, okay, yeah, so these are the right chords. And I got, learned a few more chords, and just the whole, you know, the coordination factor just fell into place. And from then on, it's been nonstop.
So I mean, that obviously that's a true story.
And it's a true story.
It was leaps and bounds for you. I mean, it was like you being better than all your other guitar buddies.
At the time, I mean, there wasn't any, I was always playing with older guys. I mean, I had some childhood bands, but the guys were always a couple years older than me. I had one band that we started making money when we were 11, you know.
Is that the trio?
There was a lot of trios. But, there was a band called the Blueberry Waterfall. It's a classic. My buddy Bobby Brown, not that Bobby Brown, yeah. Another Bobby Brown. He's not with us anymore, God bless him. His mom, you know, like she was kind of, she just would stay in her room, and we had full run of the house, guitars, amps, and drum sets. And we played all the time. We had full run of the house. It was great. The pool. It was like the greatest hang in the world. He's my best friend. And we, you know, we worked up a bunch of tunes. We played at the graduation and stuff like, or not, that wasn't the graduation. It was some event at Rio Vista School down the street. In the auditorium, all the girls screamed and everything. That was it. You know, I was bullied terribly as a kid. I was terrible at sports. I was really small.
Wow.
They used to beat the shit out of me and just fuck with me. And I was really shy and tortured. You know, there was kids on the school bus that would just have their way with me every day. And all of a sudden, when I play, they didn't know I played. I didn't say nothing. I just used to play after school, you know. And then when we played, all of a sudden everything changed. And that reaction and that was one thing I could do that I wasn't good at sports, but they couldn't do what I did.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, that sort of changed everything.
That's so cool. I mean, were there lots of concerts? I mean, going and checking out bands?
I wasn't really allowed to go see all this. I wanted to go see Hendrix at the, you know, but my parents were like, no, he's a Hendrix guy, drugs, and, you know. I was just a kid, you know, 10, 11 years old. But I could, you know, play Foxy Lady and stuff like that. I used to go find the older kids. There was this guy named Mark Hollingsworth. I'll never forget. He's a really sweet guy. He would come over to Bobby's house. His mom would pay him money to teach us new songs. And he taught me, like, a lot of stuff, you know. And that was the first fuzz tone I ever, you know, had, wow. A wah-wah pedal and all that stuff. So I was, like, 11 years old playing with this stuff.
Wow.
You know, so I could, you know, had the first blues scale stuff together. You know, you can see pictures of me up on the 12th fret. Like, but the guitar looks like it's about, like, 300 times my size. Like, the mic stands all the way down to the lowest point. So I was about, like, this big, you know.
What kind of guitar was it? A
Fender Jaguar, Duosonic, you know, some stuff like that. A Fender Boss Tone Fuzz and a wah-wah pedal, you know, and plugged into whatever amp I could get. And when we played some of these gigs, we went to play the Teenage Fair.
But
they wouldn't let us play because we weren't teenagers yet. But they, somebody let us get up and play a couple of songs on the big stage, the Hollywood Palladium, and we fucked them all up because we were actually pretty good. But we got on these big amps, and we didn't know what to do with ourselves. You know what I mean? All of a sudden, this wall of like acoustic amplifiers, loudest thing I've ever heard in my life. And I remember walking up to the microphone, and it wasn't grounded.
Oh man!
And it had a curly cord coming out of the. And it's just like, who knew this shit? Man, I couldn't have been 80, 90 pounds wet. You know what I mean? And I hit this fucking, my lip hit this thing holding on the guitar, man. I did see Jesus. Jesus spoke to me, man. I mean, it was like lights out. I almost think the lights in the whole place dimmed a little bit, you know. I should have been dead, really. I just remember my lip sticking to this thing. Coming away from that, trying to be cool.
Yeah.
I was even trying to keep it together then. Like, normally a kid would burst out into tears or something. But that one came out, and then we played, and people were like, I can't believe you can play, and I got a lot of those pats on the back for, hey, you're great for a kid. Because there wasn't a lot of kids like today, now.
No, exactly.
Every fetus that pops out has a guitar in its
hand.
That's
right.
And I got, my son makes a record. My son has a man that makes records. You know, everybody can make a DVD now.
Yeah.
I mean, it used to be like records with like these mythical studio. Where do people make these sounds, and how does this all happen, you know?
That's exactly
now
right.
It's like, you know, it's like, before you become a magician, you know all the tricks. Now that's kind of where it's at now.
Were you buying albums? Were you trying
I used to beg for albums. I used to do chores for albums. You know, I didn't have any of the good gear. See, I used to borrow all the gear because my parents were like, okay, this is cute. He'll grow out of it. You know, because I announced to my parents, oh, I'm going to be I'm going to be a rock star or whatever they called it back then. I think the rock star was a later terminology. I want to be like the Beatles. And my dad patted me on the head. Like, that's cute, kid. Because you know you got 1 in a billion chance of making this, right? And my dad was in showbiz, you know. I mean, he was behind the camera. Like, he was doing, like, Dream of Jeannie and stuff at that time, you know. You can see his name on late night TV. That's my dad. Anyway, so he goes, you got a billion to one chance of making this. And without even thinking it, I just said, well, that'll be me.
Wow.
And he just kind of looked at me like, really?
Yeah.
He goes, well, good luck, kid. You know, thinking, like, what was I, 9 or 10 years old coming out with this? Like, you know, I might as well have said, yeah, I'm going to be an astronaut and land on Mars, too. And he would have given me the same reaction.
Yeah.
Thinking, you know, it was the only thing that's been consistent in my life, you know, is the music aspect of it all. I mean, I had this tunnel vision, like, it was never not going to happen.
Wow.
Even though I was told a million times, you know.
God, that's pretty cosmic. I mean, that's pretty special. You know what I mean? It's like many guys have that, especially so young.
It was weird, you know. I was like I played better than the other guys, and I started playing all the other instruments and showed everybody how to play their parts stuff, you know. But, you know, it was just my mother won a piano on the Hollywood Squares, and I taught myself how to play that, you know, when I was like 10 or 11 years old. I found older guys to play with, and you know, then the first kid to come along that blew my mind was Mike Landau, because we met when we were 12 years old.
Like, oh really?
It's like there's another guy that's like your age that can play really good. And we met, and we've been lifelong friends ever since. He's one of the finest guitar players and musicians I've ever known. Gifted cat, another kid. It just felt very natural, you know. So we had this little neighborhood full of guys. So another one was a bass player named John Pierce. Who's a studio player.
Oh, yeah.
He was my first friend in life. Matter of fact, our parents were pregnant at the same time on the same block. So we came into the world at like the same, within a month of each other. And we've been lifelong friends ever since. And he's a great musician, bass player.
Ridiculous.
Studio guy, plays with Huey Lewis now, but he does all sorts of other cool stuff. And the three of us, like out of the hood, all the guys in the neighborhood went off to be successful until when we, all three of us, ended up in the Picaros, at, you know, Steve Picaro's band in high school, where we met all the Picaro brothers. And so that's then our journey, everything changed then. In junior high, everybody had the local neighborhood bands.
Yeah.
We'd all play with each other and have different configurations, different permutations of guys. We'd get a gig. We'd all either help each other or support each other, or we'd all play together and sit in with each other and borrow each other's gear, practice together. It was a very, nobody had the TV and stuff, you know what I mean? There was nothing, you wanted to get out of the house. You know, when I woke up in the morning when I was a kid, when my parents would punish me, they'd take away the stereo and the guitar. They wouldn't say I couldn't watch TV. I could care about TV except for once a week to see Ed Sullivan or to see something, you know, that was music-oriented or a favorite cartoon or something like that. But really, I wanted to get out of the house, so music was like something we'd all did. We used to concentrate on music. Usually, you get a new album, you go find the guy with the best stereo system and go to their house. Yeah, we were all like kids, you know, start to smoke pot and stuff like that. And just, you know, crazy little early, you know, 1970, 71, all that stuff was going on. You know, guys had blacklight rooms and parents that, like, were never home.
Blacklight posters.
You know, the whole thing, you know, like with the older brother and sister would go, hey, what do you kids want to smoke a little weed or something?
Yeah.
It was kind of silly, you know.
So were the Picaros, it sounds like they were actually a little ahead of you. Well, I mean, kind of already out there doing their thing.
Well, when we hit high school, we had heard of, we would always find out who the local bands were in when we were seeing. We heard the legend of Jeff Picaro was already around.
It was.
And, you know, when we met Steve, it was like Jeff was already, he had just joined Steely Dan. So we had kind of came into that situation, and we all of a sudden started finding out about all the studio guys and all that, and that was something I was really interested in. All of us. And, you know, we wanted to be, and then Jeff would come around, he would meet, hang, him and Paige would come around, like, they'd sit in with us when we were rehearsing in the garage.
I mean, that must have been ridiculous, right?
Steely
Dan kind of.
Yeah, well, we had, like, the rhythm tracks to Katie Lied, and we learned all these songs before the record came out. We used to play them at high school dances and stuff like that. And me and Landau on guitar, we covered all the parts, you know?
Wow.
Like, he was more of the Danny Diaz guy, and I was more of the Skunk Baxter guy, gotcha. You know? And, you know, we were just crazy hellraisers, you know? And we had so much fun. But we were all studying music. We were studying either privately or at the Dick Grove School or whatever, you know? We were all taking... We took our music really seriously. Everybody was deeply into it. And that changed everything. We met the Picaro Brothers... And all that game, Carlos Vega was playing drums with us at the time, you know, and then Jeff would come sit in with us, and Paige would come sit in with all of our high school bands. There's a tape rolling around. We had a couple of different singers that would come, you know, that were in the band. So we had like five-part harmonies and stuff like that. And we used to work, and Steve would write out all the parts and stuff like that.
So, I mean, if a musician rolled in who wasn't quite up to snuff, he would just kind of, I mean... Well, you had to make the grade, I mean, to play with you guys. I mean, that was it's a pretty...
Well, we were just a close-knit group of friends that, like, you know, we were all in all other side projects and bands and stuff. We were just, it was every day you wake up in the morning, eat it, drink it, sleep it, fuck it, whatever. We were all had this tunnel vision, like, we were going to make it.
So Jeff doing the session thing kind of
put
the thing into
Jeff was already, you know, legendary at the time, and Dave was right there, you know, so these are the guys, we wanted to be like them. You know, and so, like, you know, to get that through that affiliation, I got to meet like Larry Carlton and Jay Graydon and people like Rittenour and people like that, you know, when I was a kid. And Larry used to let me come by the house and hang, you know, and then I met David Foster, Willie Ornelas, and then Mike Baird and then Lee Sklar. And, you know, and I ended up getting I remember Jeff calling me for like one of my very first sessions that I ever did. It was for, he was working with Richard Perry. Diana Ross record. You know, I was doing demo sessions. Like, like a minor league thing. Like,
sure.
Because there was no machines to do this stuff. So they used to hire musicians to play, like, you know, $20 a tune, $25 a tune. So I was making, you know, you had to make a living. I had to pay for my own car and pay for my own insurance, gas, and guitar strings and all the things that I needed. So, I mean, it was like, you know, we were all studying and then doing every shitty gig. I do weddings. I do whatever. Studying and, you know, trying to apply the reading thing and just, you know, trying to be a full, well-rounded musician so I could be like a studio guy.
Yeah.
You know, we still wanted to have our own band and do our own
you
music
did. I mean,
and
you
be
knew
rock
that was
and rollers,
the ultimate...
but at the same time, there was something incredibly attractive to, like, the, you know, all of a sudden, every record I picked up that I really dug had the same names on it. And I go, you know, these all of a sudden, then Jeff would, and Steve Picaro and everybody would, no, you got to get into so-and-so. You got to go see, you know, Rittenour and Harvey Mason down at the Baked Potato, and you got to go down to Dante's, which is, and see Larry and Robin Ford, and you got to, you know. So I was always in the audience, like, you know, I've taken everything, you know, I was like a huge sponge. You know, and this is the days when you lift a needle off the record and learn the solos. I mean, everybody's got it way too fucking easy now. How to learn it in 2 seconds. Oh, Google this. There was no discovery. There was no work. When you had to pick up, learn a solo off a record like that, when you're listening, learning Kid Charlemagne or something, you know, and you're taking that needle off, or Hendrix, or Clapton, or Beck, or Page, or anything that we dug, or all the prog rock stuff, you know, Steve Hackett and Steve Howe, man, it was complex stuff. Lifting that needle up, man, you know, and most of the time you fuck it up and play it wrong, like you get most of it, And then you'd find some guy, older guy, go, no, no, it's like this. You go, oh, that's the magic voicing. So that's how you finger that. You know what I mean? I thought you'd try to do all this sort of shit. So, you know, when you learn something, there's a sense of accomplishment, you know, and ear training and concentration that is just right out the fucking window now, man.
It's unbelievable. I mean, so those early sessions, I mean, are you nervous walking in there? Are you like, sure. I can play whatever they put in front of me. I can come up with the
it parts. Was, I mean, you know, the reading thing was weird because, you know, I didn't learn how to read until I was like 14 and a half, you know. I had been playing since I was 7. So, like, the trying to learn how to do that, I could already play all this, you know, all this stuff. But, you know, I was back going down, 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 down. Da, 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 da. And my ears were really good, so my teacher Jimmy Weibel, God bless him, he would, you know, give me a level of reading or something like that, and I'd be struggling through the reading aspect of it, and I'd come back the next week and I'd memorize it in 2 seconds or whatever, like that. Not 2 seconds, but when I met David Foster, he had a huge influence on me growing in the studio, same with Jay Graydon, you know, who used to throw me all of his extra work. Because Carlton was kind of like becoming a solo artist that time, so he was kind of on his way out. But he was like the, you know, Larry Carlton, you know what I mean? And then Ritt, you know, and then all the other guys. These guys were already becoming artists. So they were there was going to be a couple of slots opening up. And Graydon started doing, he dug me. We're still lifelong friends. He's Trevor's godfather, you know. All these guys are my friends. I talked to Larry yesterday. I got a text from, you know, these Ray Parker Jr. We used to do... Sit next to Ray. Now, Ray, everybody thinks Ray's like, oh, the Ghostbusters guy. One of the finest rhythm guitar players on planet Earth and most creative on the spot. We used to sit next to each other and come up with parts. Like, they just give us chord charts, you know. And like, Ray would come up with something a little funky, and I'd go, okay, I'll find some other picking thing to compliment that.
Wow.
And now, these conversations were very short because within 2 takes, you had to have your part. And most of the time, it was just chord stuff. They'd hire us to, like, come up with these hooky little parts.
Yeah.
And that was, nowadays, guys get writer's credit for this stuff. There's something sadly missing in the... of, like, sitting in a room with a bunch of great players and never hearing a song before. No, there's no demo. You showed up and go... Some guy would play a song on acoustic guitar or a piano, and you'd have a chord chart in front of you, and you'd go... You check out the roadmap, make sure they're like, okay, take the DS. So you got that? What, change the arrangement a little bit. And everybody come up with ideas of how to rearrange the song. All of a sudden, this guy's... 3-chord song turned into this piece with Jeff Vaccaro playing drums and all these great parts kind of flowing together. And he goes, that's where we got the calls, man,
yeah.
Because we could go in and do that. And I was a little bit more rock and roll than, say, like Lee and Larry and their jazz influence. You know, they could cross the line, but it was kind of the opposite. They were jazz guys that got into rock and roll. We were rock guys that got into jazz.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So I would never call myself a jazz player because that would be an insult to the real jazz players. But I certainly have been very influenced by that, and not just a blues pentatonic guy.
You know? Absolutely.
But sort of in my own way. And there was a lot of fun. All the Quincy stuff was really a lot of fun. Because I was just in my early 20s when we started doing all that stuff, like The Dude and did Thriller. I was the same age as Michael. I think I was 23, 24 years old. But we got to, you know, come up with all this stuff. And it was really expected. You got Quincy Jones in your face going, okay, what do you got?
Yeah.
You know? And you come up with all these cool little rhythm parts. Because that wasn't like a shredding thing at all.
Right, no.
My amp never got turned up, except on Beat It, you know. Which, no, you know, Eddie gets all the love, but, you know, which is fine, you know. We joke about it to this day.
Right, but you play those beautiful...
Well, it's not even so much that. I just did the heavy lifting, you know. We had, Jeff Vaccaro and I had to put that record back together again after Ed cut the 2-inch tape and it wouldn't sync back up again. And so there was one 24-track slave tape that had Michael's lead vocal, master lead vocal, Eddie's solo, and a drum case on 2 and 4 with Michael. And since Eddie cut the tape, they couldn't sync back up the other stuff to the master tape. So Jeff went out and played a drum part because his time was so good, he could just nail it. And then I played all the, you know, the riff guitar parts,
yeah.
and the bass part. And we sent it to Quincy. The first version had like the Marshall stacks all over it. It was like... Because he's like, that's too much, it's too much. We'll never get on. We got to get it on pop radio, you know. Use the small amps. And like, I go, okay, you know. So I just took out the deluxe and did that, you know, and turned down the gain a little bit. So I give the halfway there. And we did that. Then I went and did all the, you know, all the da-da-da-da-da-da parts with Michael, you know, because we kind of worked on that together. Yeah, but we did a whole bunch of stuff on that record. The Human Nature was basically a total song with with Michael, and I came up with that little muted guitar part on the spot with Quincy, because he gotta make it funky. Gotta make it funky. Well, here's the thing. When my career started in the studios, we were working on the first Toto album.
I see.
So, I mean, you're looking, I was 19 when we started Toto's first album, and that's when my studio career started to take off. So in the midst of all this, it all blew up at the same time. And we were working on the Toto record at certain parts of the day or night, and then the rest of it was like, if you go, I got a week's worth of sessions at sunset from noon to 6, I'll come in afterwards or whatever. And that's how we all worked. So there was always, sometimes we just, people would bring their tapes to our studio and we just do the overdubs there, you know. If it was tracking sessions, then, you know, we had, you know, various different kinds of gear all over town, cartridge companies, but you'd sneak out. I'd be in some studios, just people just grab me and pull me into a studio. You could do a solo on this. 10 minutes later, I was out and on to the next one. I wasn't even supposed to be there. It was a really fruitful time for us, you know.
I mean, what was that first Toto record like? Kind of making that record
slow. Then. I mean, we took 9 months to do it. We were like, it was Jeff and Dave's baby. Coming off the Boss Gag Silk Degrees tour. Now I was on the summer tour, world tour for that record, but I didn't play on Silk Degrees. We was working on the follow up Down to the Left, which I did play on.
Right.
And at that time, my whole studio thing started to blow up. Now, my affiliation with Boz, that Jeff brought me and Steve Picaro into, actually, that whole thing was, we had started doing some demos. Dave and Jeff started doing some demos at Davlin Studios down the street. And I, you know, everybody wanted to be play guitar in that band. I mean, it was like, I really shouldn't have got the gig. There were some other cats, probably to this day, that wish I was dead.
So you weren't going to be the default guitar player?
I wanted to be. Everybody wanted to be. Any guitar player in L.A.
I mean, like Mike Landau could have been the guitar player in Toto.
Could have been other guys. There was older guys that wanted the gig, you know, that were already established. You know, we were the young bucks coming up. And all of a sudden, I moved into that slot by accident. I don't know why. Jeff took a shine to me, man. He really loved me. And I will be for. And you know, if I hadn't met Steve Picaro, my whole life would be much different. Hmm. I have to owe it to that whole family for taking me in. He saw something in me. I don't know what it was, because, you know, they invited me down to play on some of the demo stuff, which I did. And then I think Jeff was like, you know, I'm going to take him on the road with Boz and see what he's all about. You know, so I got this call.
I see.
And Les Dudek was the other guitar player. But Les and Boz had a falling out. And they were going to get somebody else. And Jeff goes, no, just let the kid play, man. He can do all this stuff. Let him play. So I went to rehearsal, and we started rehearsing with Les, and, you know, and I was going to do all the jazzier stuff, and Les was going to do all the rock and roll stuff. You know, I said, I was just happy to be there, you know, whatever, you know. And Les quit, and I moved right into the sled, and then Boz, well, let's hear what, you know, then I ripped it a couple times at the rehearsal, and Jeff stood up by the drum set and points at me and goes, look no further. Kept going like, am I in, man? Am I, you know? They fucked with me too because they knew how bad I was.
Did they?
Like, yeah, they were like, I don't know, man. You know? And then it would be really tough because I'd be sitting there doing something, and all of a sudden, all of their friends would show up, all the guitar player guys that thought that they had the gig, you know, and they'd be staring me down. It was really brutal, man. You know, I don't really think of myself as a very good singer. I can sing okay. I sing my own shit all right, but you know, I've got a chance to work with some real singers. You know what I mean? And there's a difference. You know, I'm like songwriter, singer guy. You know, out of default. I think David, that was one of the things that helped me get in the band, actually, was the fact that I could sing, because they wanted to have a band with multiple singers.
Yeah.
Like, we kind of patterned ourselves off of Steely and Beatles and all of our heroes, you know what I mean? And, you know, you also felt like, well, maybe it would be, like, taking the heat off of one guy, you know what I mean? So, David sang a lot on the first album. I did. Steve Picaro sang a song. He was our Ringo, vocally. You know, but he was actually good, you know, and we were teasing him about it now just the other day, because we were digging out some old songs we're going to play on this tour. He's like, no, Joe can do me better than me, I'm not going to sing. I go, come on, man, you sing all the first time, you know. So, but, you know, we all sang, and but there, you know, we've always had that, our singer spot was much like the Spinal Tap's drummer, where they all just blow up.
And you're actually going out on the 35th anniversary tour now.
It's mind-boggling to think it was actually 36 years ago we got together, but 35 years since the first album came out.
Remarkable.
Yeah, we're, and you know, the core of us that are still here and have the ability to do so,
which
is Steve Picaro, David Page, Joseph Williams, and myself, and then we have Nathan East sitting in for Mike, who's going through a tough time with the ALS.
About that. I'm so sorry about that.
And then Jeff's not with us anymore, and Simon Phillips has been with us for 20-some-odd years. He's a brilliant musician. I mean, Jeff is just, you know, when that happened, man, it was like a piece of all of us went with him, you know. I think, you know, that's, I mean, Simon's done a brilliant job, no question about it, made it his own. But, you know, Jeff was, that was like losing my big brother.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, my mentor, so to speak, you know. Whenever I had a problem about anything, I'd call him. You know? He was always there, and he helped so many musicians, more than they even had. Some may not even know it. He was just a very special cat.
It really was. It really was. I mean, you know, you talk about the Beatles, Steve, and obviously you just came back from Ringo's All-Stars. I mean,
that's been the greatest
thing.
That
must be a little surreal, right? I mean, that's kind of...
Well, you know, I got a chance to work with Paul on Michael's record.
That's true.
And
we're going to talk about that.
And then I ran into George... Like right before we,
right, you did
in '92.
The benefit tour, right?
Yeah, well, when Jeff passed, we did the tour. We came back and we were playing at the amphitheater to do a benefit. And I ran into him like 3 or 4 days before. And I sat down with him. And he just kind of liked me. And, like, you know, we just hit it off. And I said, hey, you know, we're doing this thing, you know. You know, then I explained what happened. He was like, oh, wow, he's such a soulful cat. And I said, come down to the gig, and we're going to come out and play, and we're going to do a little help for my friends. And I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah, I gave him my number and everything like that. You know, I said, just come down, I'll make sure, I'll put you on the list, you know. And, like, I leave, after a first up, I'm blown away that I got to change my first guitar hero, George Harrison. You know? And he was so nice and so cool and so funny. And we sat there and shot the shit for about 2 hours, and I left, you know, and I told the guys about it. I said, yeah, I said, I know he's not going to show up. But, I mean, what a great night it was. And all of a sudden, we're at the gig, and I get this, there's somebody here to see you. And I go, well, who is it? George Harrison's here. And I'm like, you're shitting me. And he came in, and he was like, you know, do you want to play? He goes, yeah, okay, I'll do it, you know. And he wasn't even, and we already had, like, the star-studded event of life. You know, Eddie Van Halen came and played. And Ed had never played live with anybody before, you know, I mean. We had Donald Fagen out of retirement before he put Steely Dan back together again. And then we had Mike McDonald, and then David Crosby showed up with Mike McDonald, and Boz was there, you know. It was just all, there was a all sort of crazy, James and Howard, Lenny was there. I mean, there's almost too many people to get up on the stage, you know, plus all of us, you know. It was a very hard night for, I mean, it was deep. But I have pictures of me and George playing together. But, you know, then you come full circle all these years later, I get the call to work with Ringo.
I mean...
And now it's like, you know, here I'm standing in Hamburg and I get a text, it's Ringo. How you doing? He's my friend. I mean, I love this man so much. I mean, he's just really a special cat, man. I mean, I look up to him in ways that, like, I mean, I've always been a fan. How can you not be a fan? This is a man that's everything you could ever want him to be. I turned down all his opportunities. I mean, Elton asked me to join his band at one point. Joni Mitchell asked me to do a tour. Miles Davis asked me to do a tour. And I couldn't ever do it. And this one, I said, I'm doing this one. Okay, sorry. And as it turns out, it's been really good for all the way around. So I get the best of both worlds. I'm living a great life right now. Here I am, 55 years old. I'm busier than I've ever been. It takes me out of town. It's cost me in some other areas, personally, but what the heck, man? You know, I got to do this, you know? But, I mean, working with Paul was incredible. Me and Jeff got called after the Thriller session to go over to London, you know, and be in his movie and be around him. And him and Linda just took a shine to me and Jeff. You know, we were set up live on the soundstage. Now, this is 1982.
82.
And, like, you know, and we were told, like, hey, man, don't, like, talk about the Beatles. And don't, like, you know, even though we did when we met him. Yeah, you know, we were hanging, you know, in between takes, and, like, you know, Paige starts playing the end of Day in the Life on the piano, dude, perfectly played, you know. And it was like he started talking about it. We were shooting the shit, and yeah. So when we get over there, you know, we're set up live on a soundstage, and, like, there's the Mellotron from Strawberry Fields. Okay, I'm standing next to Linda, you know, and, like, we had been hanging out for a couple of days, so, you know, everybody kind of more relaxed, you know. We had this ridiculous makeup on; it was insane. That's a whole other story, but. But I'm going, like, you know, I go, and it's plugged in. I hit it, and it's plugged into the monitor. I go, and I start fucking around, and I find the, you know, the flute setting, you know, Strawberry Fields. I go, blah. I'm like, oh, God. You know. I'm told, like, so I go to Linda, and I go, I want to play this so bad, but they told us that we shouldn't play any Beatles stuff or talk about the Beatles with Paul. And she goes, what? What are you talking about? I go, yeah, man, the people that, you know, called Jeff and I said it was a big scene, that Paul would be really upset or something. She goes, that's rubbish. She goes, play it. I go, okay, I'm going to get in trouble. She goes, look, and she was so sweet. I'm telling you, that's a great woman. She was, God bless her soul. She was incredibly cool.
Yeah.
Anybody that talks shit about her never met her.
Yeah.
That's all I can tell you. But she was hilarious. So I said, well, this is it. If I do this, man, I'm really stepping on, you know. So I start playing it, you know. The beginning. Played it note for note, you know.
I'm sure you did.
And I was shitting myself because if I fuck this up, all of a sudden, every like 4,000 eyes are on me, you know, including Paul. And then George Martin is in the truck with Jeff Emmerich, the guys that, you know, producer and engineer for the record, on the Mellotron with McCartney looking at me and Linda right here. And she cracked up. I was like so giddy that I actually played it right. And I look over Paul and I said, I'm really sorry. I couldn't help myself. He goes, no, that's great. He goes, then he starts telling some stories about, you know, the sessions. And then I said, okay, gloves are off. And I started playing Please Please Me. Jeff jumped in and Paul starts singing it. And the place was silent. And we played the song. And I played all the right chords and all the shit. And at the end of it, man, the place erupted, you know. And then Paul was like, that was a lot of fun. He goes, and he started telling the stories. And then okay, let's move on. Let's get on, you know. But the ice had been broken. We had another 2 weeks there. So needless to say, like every, you know, Jeff and me and Paul and Linda would hang out on every break and every lunch, dinner, because you're at EMI Elstree Studios from 6 in the morning until, you know, they call it at 8 at night or whatever. Dude, these guys changed the world. And that, to be around that, to be around these guys and to have some history with them is the dream come true. You know? I've gotten a chance to work with a lot of my heroes. And the most talented ones are always the coolest people, generally speaking. And that was a special one because that's where it all started.
Did you tell them that?
Oh, I had a chance to tell them. Yeah. I wrote Paul a long letter once when it was all over. You know,
that is so cool.
And it got to him, you know, and let him know how much the experience meant to me.
That is so cool, man.
And, you know, obviously, you know, I had a chance to tell Ringo that, you know. That's it's so really cute because there's a bit in the DVD, the Ringo Live DVD we did last summer that I had said something to him like, because he'd have each guy introduce the next guy.
Mm-hmm.
And it was his birthday. So I said, look, you know, this was a great honor, something to the effect of, he's the reason why I play, you know. And
that is so
you
cool.
You know, I mean, he knows.
I have to ask you about Clapton. I mean, we're talking about heroes. I mean, I know that he was kind of one of your guys. I mean,
I talked my way onto a session with him. It was the only time I ever really kind of froze up on a session because I was just, I don't know why. It hit me that way. But I talked my way onto the session because they didn't need me. They had hired Jeff and Nathan and all these guys. And I heard about it. And I'm like, I want to play on this club. I don't want any money. I don't want to do it. I just want to be there. I want to meet him. And he was so nice to me. But I kind of like, you know, the tune was Forever Man or something like that.
Oh, you were on Forever Man.
Yeah. But I just played a little bit of rhythm on it. I mean, I don't even know if I'm, you could hardly hear me on it. But because I didn't know what to play. I mean, like, we it's like all of a sudden we start jamming and he throws a solo to me. And I didn't know really, I didn't want to like, okay, I don't want to step on it. I don't want to like, but then I don't want to, you know, I started overthinking. So I sort of meekly played some stuff. I didn't really stuff. But he was really nice when he first met me. He's like, I want you to know that, like, you know, I heard Roseanne on the radio, cause, and I really, really dug what you did. You
wow.
Know? And that really meant a lot to me, you know. But I never really got to, you know, and we played together one other time with Elton at the Hollywood Bowl. Elton invited us both out to play at the same time. But I sort of really laid back with Eric, and I would have liked to have another chance to play with him someday, you know.
I mean, he was one
I was
of
really
guys.
Nervous, you know, that's all. So I didn't really want to get in his way, except I had talked my way out of the session.
Yeah.
So I kind of like meekly got in and out. I didn't really like show him my shit or whatever.
Gotcha.
I felt out of respect. I didn't really want to do anything. I didn't want to come off like I'm trying to hot dog the guy. Because I somebody I deeply admire, but he was very kind to me, you know. But then he was very, you know, standoffish kind of, so I didn't want to force it. I never got a call to do the Crossroads thing or anything like that. You know, I'd like to do that maybe someday, but, you know, I guess, you know, that's his choice, and, you know, if he ever so desires, I'd been great, but I'm not the kind of person to call somebody on the phone, hey, I'm not that guy,
gotcha,
you know,
man.
I'm really kind of like...
back in the day, Steve, it was kind of all the Cream records and...
Oh, yeah, you kidding me? I wore those out. I love them all. It's funny, you meet all your heroes, and you talk about this stuff, and he's like, right, yeah, y'all like that stuff. We did the same thing with Miles Davis. Like, you know, we love all that old season. Hey, you like all that shit. Trying to get him to play, like, Sketches of Spain or something like that. You know what I mean? It's like, you were kind of thinking this thing. It's like Miles, he's cracking up, going like, yeah, you like all that shit.
I don't. You just sound, you feel so comfortable with it.
And I've been through a lot of life-changing things in the last 4 or 5 years. You know, I changed my whole life, my whole way I lived, the way I, you know, I got rid of all the childish parties bullshit, you know, I quit drinking, smoking cigarettes and doing all kinds of stupid shit and got really super healthy, changed everything, all the people in my life, things fell, some relationships fell apart, some became stronger, I had younger kids again, my older kids are kind of growing up out of the house, my oldest daughter's getting married, my son's a musician, making his first record, and then I got the little guys here, I'm taking, going to kindergarten again, you know, it's weird, I'm like, you know, I'm divorced again, but, you know, thankfully very tight with my ex, you know. We've developed a different relationship, which I'm very happy and that we're cool enough for our kids and for our own sanity. I mean, I don't want to get beat up. It's like, what do you want, you know? Take what you want. And she was really cool about it, you know, as cool as you can be in these situations. So,
can I ask you a semi-personal question?
Yeah.
You obviously like being married, you like being around somebody, right?
Well, I liked it. This is the first time in the last 3 years of my life that I've been alone without a girlfriend at all for 3 years of my entire adult life.
Wow.
I got so immersed in my young children and my work, and I'm on the road now because the record business is kind of dead. You know, you can't depend on it to pay your nut, certainly. You know, I mean, you know, we make records and you can do okay, but gone are the days of old, you know what I mean?
Wow,
so the money's on the road. I mean, I got three different tours. I do my solo stuff, I do Toto, and then I'm doing Ringo. Last year I was honored to do G3 with Joe and Steve and John at a different time. You know, that was another nerve-wracking but wonderful experience.
I mean, while we're there, I mean, 25 words on the G3 tour?
25 words. I got a lot more than 25 words.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you have to understand, when I quit booze and all this stuff like that, I was a raw nerve. I mean, my whole life was, my mother died. I mean, it was very brutal.
I'm very sorry about that.
You know, my son and I found her on Father's Day, Dad. You know, she's just, the way she went was really awful. And, you know, she was such a big support for me and believed in my dream. And when my dad was on the road, she let me get away with a lot of shit, you know, for the music. And, you know, God bless her for that. But, you know, I was a raw nerve, so I started over in so many aspects of my life. And as a musician, it was weird for me to play live again without, you know, some sort of anesthesia to kind of take. I found out that I actually did have a little bit of stage fright that I wasn't aware of. And I was so terribly insecure because there was a time when I was over the top and because I was so miserable inside of myself for many different reasons that I never really even realized until it all really took the mask off, you know. And really had to tear it down to the raw nerves and take the punches. Now I realized that there was a point where I was overplaying. I was doing all this other. I was living an insane life that was unrealistic and very shame. I'm very ashamed of some aspects of that. That, you know, sure, yeah, be the clown, ha ha ha. But at the end of the day, the clown, you know, isn't that funny, you know? And I had to come to grips with all that. So playing out again was very difficult. I was very tentative. I look at my fingers and I go, I know this is right, but it doesn't feel right. So it was almost like reconnecting my brain to like the right way. So I really got deep into the woodshed and started over again. So, I mean, my songwriting, the depth of that, I've been writing journals instead of trying to write lyrics, you know, and through those, much better process of writing about what I felt and what I was viewing as an older guy who's been around the world a few times. And just became more mature musician, got rid of all the slop and bullshit and plug into an amp and it changed my whole sound and my whole way of approaching the instrument. And, you know, you still practice chop stuff, but, you know, the idea is to play a little bit more substance than that, and that was coming into my solo records. And reinventing myself as a musician, like I've stood up public and said, yeah, I was a fuck up, I'm sorry. You know, some old drunken YouTube and just the comments are just brutal, you know, I mean, people just want to, like, take a baseball bat with nails into it to you, like, you know, kick them when they're up, kick them when they're down. As Hanley said, the song that I played on, me and Joe Walsh played on, Dirty Laundry, my brother Joe, one of my heroes. But you know, it still holds true. You know, people love to kick a man when he's down. You know, and the thing is, when you come to and you see all of the punches really hurt. So I was for about a year and a half, 2 years. I was all fucked up by it. I almost quit. I almost said, okay, that's it. Time to cash out. They've had their way with me for the last time. There's better guys. There's better guitar players. I don't want to be in this race anymore. I don't want to do it anymore. You know, I'm not trying to be the best anything. I'm trying to be the best person I can be. Music got better as I let go of that childish shit. You know, I'm trying to be the fastest guy in the West. It's a 20-year-old's game, not me. I played that. And, you know, it's like anything else. You try too hard and it suffers. When you relax and let it flow and you become a little bit more spiritual like I have, and changed my life. I'm a better player, better musician, better friend to people, better father. You know, I mean, ask my older kids. I mean, even my ex likes me. So, you know, both of my exes like me. I'm not that horrible of a man. I got lost in it, man. You know, they take me as a teenager and throw me in the deep end of the pool. And, you know, in all the craziest decades you could think of, the end of the 70s, 80s, and, you know, crazy, you know. And we all got sucked into it as to what level, you know. And I stopped all the drug shit, but I just kept drinking because I thought, look, people drinking, everybody drinks. You know? It's all part of the thing. It's all part of the ritual of showing up at the gig. And, you know, when you're young, you kick that shit off and you play your ass off and shit. But he gets to be 50 years old. It's like, you know, everything's, you know, the brain doesn't, you don't process it the same way.
I get it.
And it wasn't working anymore. That was, and my life wasn't working. So when I came to, I just one day said, that's it. There was no event. There was no rehab AA thing. And although most of my friends do all that stuff, some have struggled, some have come out of it. It was like all my drinking buddies don't drink anymore. We didn't, you know, it's kind of funny, actually. But we're still sick mentally and humor-wise, so it doesn't all go away. If anything, it's more sharp and acerbic, you know what I mean? But that's the fun of it. I'm still, you know, the thing is that we're all still like 20 years old in our souls. But, yeah, you know, exactly. I'm going to walk by a mirror, I'm fine. You know, it's like, well, I mean, you've known me for a long time.
So. Long, long time.
I mean, the hair is real, but the color ain't, you know. But I've been dying it since I was 25. My mother was gray when she was 20.
Wow.
So, I mean, you know, it's just, they come from that. I look like Mike McDonald or something like that.
Steve, another kind of a semi-personal question.
Yeah, 12 inches.
Wow, nice.
I'm in my stove, my microwave is 12 inches.
I mean, back in the day, I mean, you're virtually doing a session every day, and you got to be there and in top form. And
oh, yeah, it was day and night, man.
Was it?
10 to 2 a.m.
I mean, was there drinking while you were doing
sessions? No, afterwards.
It was afterwards, so there's no way you could have done
that. No, the thing is, I mean, even the drugs and all the rest of the shit, I could not have done all this output if we were that fucked up. Oh, yeah, there's a few rough nights in there, sure, man, you know, and I'm not going to lie and say that there wasn't some extracurricular shit going on sometimes during work, but nobody was drinking on the gig because that's when the whole game changes.
Gotcha.
You know, you could have a couple of beers or something like that towards the end of the session at night, but if you had, you know, doing sessions, you had to be reading and being frosty. Yeah. You couldn't be sloppy. If you're in a rock and roll band, then, you know, the gig's okay, we're done for today when you're too fucked up or something. But even when we do our own shit, like, you know, it would be like after we went home that you start drinking afterwards. You
gotcha.
Know? I mean, just to come down from everything else, you know, yeah. From the day and or whatever other shit was going on.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Those did, but that was like, you know, the 80s, early, you know, 70s and 80s shit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The aliens have landed, and they find the Steve Lukather time capsule. And
yeah.
And there's three songs.
What makes you think that I'm not one of them? It's been said before. You're not of this world, bro. And it has nothing to do with musically.
Exactly.
There's so many cats better than me that's funny. But I just have the wisdom of experience. You know, I have the knowledge of living through decades, four decades of making records, four different ones. You know, well, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000s, yeah. Now 2010.
Yeah.
I've been making records and traveling around the world. No, it's not 50 years per se, but it's five different decades of five different trendy to not trendy, cool, uncool. Obviously, you know, the internet's kind of brutal with the looks. You know, the MTV years were particularly bad. We got a stylist for you. The hair, the clothes, it was everything was too much. Everything about the 80s was too much. It was fun, I guess. I mean, they tell me I had a great time anyway, but you know, that's a cliche, but there it is.
Yeah.
I wasn't any worse than anybody else. There were a lot of guys worse that didn't make it. So.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. That's great, man. Thank you so much.
No problem. Hope it works out.
Definitely.
All right, mate. Let me let my Rugrats back in the house. You want to put it?